Please remain standing. President John, distinguished guests, students, parents, and friends, as principal of George J. Penney High School, it is my pleasure once again to welcome you, this time to a very special occasion, our 21st and our final commencement exercises. We would especially like to welcome the following class presidents who have led the processional this afternoon: Donald Brink, class of 65, Stephen Photo, class of 66, Robert Good, class of 67, William Rocchio, class of 70, Glennis Saywood, class of 72, Kathleen McCaffrey Caruso, 74, Mary Rose Rataic, 75, Mary Beth Tomaselli, 79, Carrie Lee Cummings, 81, and Sharon Dosh, 83. Before we begin the formal commencement exercises, I would like to announce that we do anticipate having an official photographer to take individual pictures of the students as they receive their diplomas. That photographer at this moment has not arrived. I will keep you informed. At any rate, we do have a small photography area, if you will all cooperate, off to my left, where you can get pictures. Once again, a reminder that I will keep you informed, because we do hope to have the photographer. Secondly, we are filming once again on videotape and community access through the East Hartford Cable Company these ceremonies. They will be available on community access. You will be able to watch them sometime in July, and we will keep you informed through our switchboard and through the press when they are available. We will begin the proceedings with a Pledge of Allegiance led by the President of the Class of 1985, John Corella. At the conclusion, will you please remain standing for the playing of the National Anthem and the invocation by the Reverend Gordon S. Bates. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let us be united in prayer. Almighty Lord, King of the universe, creator of all things and eternal source of life, of wisdom, and of love, we would pause in this graduation celebration to honor you for all goodness, for all knowledge, for all energy and creativity. We give you thanks. And especially this day for Penney High School and its wonderful years of educational excellence, for its traditions and memories, for all who have taught here, and for all who have been students here, for all of its administrators and support personnel, we praise your name and give thanks. For this beautiful day, for all who have been able to come here to this place for this ceremony, we would lift our gratitude to you, the Lord of all. Bless these proceedings with your presence. Increase our reverence before the mystery of life. And give to each of us a deeper insight into your will and a new determination to replace hatred with love, to replace ignorance with knowledge, to replace prejudice with acceptance, to replace war with peace. Our Father, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse our hearts and minds by the inspiration of your Spirit, that we together, young and old, may learn to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
Honored guests, fellow graduates, parents and friends, good afternoon. For the past 4 years, I have been a student in and outside of the classroom. While a vast amount of learning took place inside the classroom, a greater amount took place after the 2 o'clock bell. These past 4 years, I've been honored enough and had the privilege to be manager of the football, basketball, and baseball teams. So, I owe coaches Danley, Lipez, Nurek, Tigno, Cipolla, and Lato, and many others a great amount of gratitude for that privilege. So rather than use this pulpit as a place to preach, I'll use it as a common ground to convey a lesson I learned 2 years ago during that state championship baseball season. It was the final game of the states. We were up against Danbury, and we jumped off to an early lead, a lead which softened us, not because we were cocky, but rather that we saw our goal just within reach. We wanted to win badly, so badly that we were afraid of losing. We feared it. I counted outs. My friends didn't want the ball hit it to them. We were nervous. After a couple of errors, Coach Lipez sat us all down on the bench, said something I'll never forget. He said, "I can face losing this game. I can accept it, but not this way. We've come too far to lose this way." He said, and I'll never forget these words, "Gentlemen, we can't win if we're afraid of losing." This fear of losing is evident in our society, but to have success, there must be a risk of failure. This ideal of not fearing losing is evident in many successes and failures alike, be it Peter Uberoff's Los Angeles Olympics, Chuck Yeager's breaking of the sound barrier, or Colonel Charles Beckwith's attempt to rescue the hostages in Iran. These men knew that the greater the gains, the greater the risk of failure, and yet they didn't let that faze them. So, we can take this same spirit of not fearing failure and take it with us in our lesser endeavors of going to school or out in the working world. My fellow graduates, thank you for 4 years of friendship and enjoyment. It's been the greatest. Mom and Dad, thank you for everything. Mrs. Brady, Mr. Falcone, I can't thank you enough for all you've done for our class. Thank you very much.
Honored guests, fellow graduates, parents, and friends, good afternoon. We're here today to honor the 1985 graduating class of George J. Penney High School. Today marks the culmination of one of the most important periods of our lives. The graduates here will be known as the last class of Penney High School, the last to be known as the Mighty Black Knights. As freshmen, we entered Penney just out of the middle school system and eager to be a part of the high school environment. Now, as seniors, we can look back wondering where it could have all gone so fast. We can think about what we've gotten out of high school. We can all say we've contributed to the school in our own personal way. We're all a small part of its history. Today ends that association. We're now older, wiser, and prouder, knowing we have accomplished a great deal because of hard work and the support of our families. Today is a day to remember the past, to think about the present, to look into the future. We can look at the history of the school, think about what has happened over the last 20 years or so. But as seniors, we have a Penney history which we can call our own. Our concern is our own tradition. We seniors can look back at what has happened to us at Penney. There have been times of great achievements and times of disappointment. There have been times of happiness and times of despair. We've made many friends and seen some of them move on to other schools or towns. The same may be said of many of the teachers. Students are not the only ones affected by the changing times. For us, it is also a day to celebrate our own achievements of the past few years. In addition, we're thinking about the future and life after high school. Looking towards the future, reflect on the thought that there will be no future alumni of George J. Penney High School. We will be the last. This afternoon marks the end of an era, the end of Penney High School. We're all the final chapter of its short history. The graduates here today are proud to be a part of that Penney tradition and what it represents. We cannot dwell on the memories of the past for long, because tomorrow starts the beginning of new ideas, new hopes, and new traditions for the remaining students of the school. The departing seniors will not be here to witness the changes of the future, because we'll be facing our own new challenges in the days and years to come. The next few years will most likely decide the path we'll take through life. Many of us will be entering the job market, some will enter the armed forces, many of us will be continuing our education at colleges and universities across the nation. We'll each go on to live our lives the way we choose. Although we are going our separate ways, our paths will cross, and one thing will bind us together. One thing will live inside us forever. We're the last to call ourselves graduates of George J. Penney High School. In approximately a week, Penney High as we know it will be absorbed into East Hartford High School. Be proud that we went to this school. Remember, so the traditions of the Penney Black Knights will never die. Our memories, at least, cannot be taken away from us. To my fellow graduates, I wish you all good luck, good health, many happy memories of this place, and a successful future. Thank you.
Thank you. honored guests, fellow graduates, parents, and friends, good afternoon. All of us are aware of the frustration we have felt when we have put off doing an assignment, a chore, or a job, only to realize that yet another chance has passed us by. What has happened in the past is just that, past. And while we can't change yesterday's events, we have a great deal of control and influence on today and tomorrow. Time can constantly work against us, or we can work with time by following the idea contained in our town's motto, Carpe Diem, and live for today. American writer A.A. Mandelow once stated, "The keynote of modern existence is speed, which is the relation of distance to time." It is significant that speed originally had the meaning of success. Western civilization today measures success by the increase in the rate of movement towards some goal we set up before us. Achievement is estimated in terms of the length of time taken to accomplish our purposes, for time is money, and in a changing universe, we have no time to waste or lose. That is, our own success will be measured both by society and by ourselves based on the length of time in which we achieve that success. We all need to set a goal and work towards accomplishing it in today's time, while at the same time remembering that tomorrow gives yet another chance. It's hard to believe that Penney High's 23-year existence has come to an end, or rather a changing point. None of us will ever forget the everyday events that made our nightlife unique, the championships games we cheered at, the concerts we attended at the Hartford Civic Center, or the lines we spent waiting for the tickets, and of course, the midnight treks to paint the rock that will always stand as a reminder of the Penney High we knew. Most importantly, we will remember each other. Everyone in this class is special in some way, and all of us are capable of turning our dreams into realities by making every day count. To the class of 1985, I wish everyone the best of luck and always future happiness. Thank you.
As a special tribute to the closing of Penney High School, we have invited two representatives from former classes to give some brief remarks this afternoon. The first one is the first president of a four-year class, the class of 1966. President of the class, now attorney, Steve Fodor. Would you come forward, please?
Twenty-five summers ago, I walked through this field as a young boy, fishing pole in hand, tackle box in hand, going to the pond over in that corner to fish. And nothing was here at that time but an empty farmer's field with vegetables wilting in a hot summer sun, much like you people out there today. A few years later, the town, in its wisdom, had decided to build and did build a new high school, much smaller than we see here today. And it stood there empty, bricks and mortar, no teachers, no students. Only time would tell how well it would serve its purpose. 4 years later, I sat where you sit, and my parents, friends, sat where you sit now, and all marveled at this miraculous metamorphosis that occurred, that changed these young boys and girls into young men and women. Now, there were a few rough spots that remained. One recalls the story of the high school senior who worked part-time as a florist, working for a florist. And as luck would have it, two assignments came into the florist. A prominent businessman had moved into town, and an elderly gentleman had died. And the florist asked the senior, "You take care of these for me?" And he said, "Sure." A few days later, the florist received an irate phone call, and it was from the prominent businessman, and he said, "What kind of a florist shop is this, getting a card like the card you sent me? Sincere sympathies on recent tragic events." And so the florist went to the senior, said, "How could you do that? That's just, I can't believe it." And the senior said to his boss, straight on, looking him in the eye, not terribly embarrassed, "Well, you think that's bad. What about the card I sent to the elderly man who just died? Best of luck on your new location." You're 17, you're 18. Mark Twain had words for those times. He said when he was 18, he looked at his parents and he just couldn't believe how ignorant they were. And that when he became 21, he was absolutely dumbfounded how much they had learned in those three short years. This is a day for memories, and I have many. I can remember Mr. Harvey exciting in me a thirst for knowledge and also to question everything I learned. I can remember Mr. Penney in the chemistry class insisting on precision in all of our lab experiments. And one girl just always felt that getting close enough was good enough. I think she now works for state government. I can remember the first dance. At first time, I was horrified to have to ask a girl for a date and mortified to be turned down. I can remember the playing fields and running cross country and losing over and over and over, but inside winning and growing. And the one time I did win, which was a JV race, Mr. Brimley, the coach, and by a lucky coincidence, the principal, John Waters, being there, and how good it felt to see their eyes as I crossed the finish line. I can remember as a class of 66, how we worked for the community, putting food baskets together at Christmas time, and how we galvanized an entire school when a radio station had a contest for which school had the most school spirit, we sat every night after school putting signatures together because it'd be measured on the number of signatures. And we had an assembly line where we signed and we signed and we signed, and we won that contest. I can remember the teachers. Most of all, I can remember a home with parents and brothers and sisters that gave me that sense of security so that I could climb up the ladder and reach higher than I otherwise could. Now, those are my memories, and I'm sure you have your own memories. They're different, they're unique to you. What really is common to both of us, we might ask? What's common is that we all went through that building behind us. But really, in being in the last class and the last time the name Penney High School will go to a class, what difference does it make? As my 5-year-old son, one of my twins, might ask, Daddy, what is sex anyways? One might ask, what is the name anyways? Why is it so important? And I would ask you to think about that for a moment. What's so important about Penney High School? What's in that name? That name, perhaps, for you is a little like your family name, whether it be Chauvin or Fitzgerald. It's a name that means years of tradition and history. And in a more immediate sense, it means to each of you an identity, parents, a home, brothers and sisters, the place you grew up, what made you what you are today and what you'll never leave behind. And so, too, Penney High School has that importance, that name, because when you came here as freshmen, and as you now sit there as seniors, 4 years have gone by in which this history of Penney High and this tradition of Penney High has seeped into your skin and into your hearts, into your spirits. So you'll always remember Penney High School. It's a part of you. But now the tradition ends. The last class graduates. The last yearbook has been published. The last dances have gone on. The last season, the last games have been played. No more will the black and gold and those pom-poms shake in the air. And no more will the letters P-E-N-N-E-Y be raised by the cheerleaders, and the cheers echo forth from the fans and the students. All of that now is past, never to happen again. Those letters in the front of the school are now going to come down. But I suggest to you, there's something much more important than the letters themselves, because as the P comes down from the front of the building, you will remember that teacher who opened up education for you and made you think and made you question. As the E comes down, that self-discipline that helps you achieve, that will remain. As the N comes down, that humility and confidence you learned on the sports fields, that will remain. As the last N comes down, the friendships you created and the meaning of friendship, that will remain. As the E comes down, those teachers who were special, that will remain. And as that final Y comes down, and as we all perhaps inside or outside shed a tear, that support and encouragement and love that your parents gave you, that will remain. And so what's really important will remain and continue and thrive as long as there's a graduate from Penney High School. And so, it's my pleasure as a member of the first 4-year graduating class to say to you, the members of the last graduating class, the membership rolls are now closed. Carry on with me and each graduate of Penney High School that tradition that we've established. Welcome, congratulations, and in thinking about that cheer and thinking about those letters coming down for a final time, perhaps you would join with me, the class of 85, in raising them one time one more time. If you'd stand, please. It's very important you only stand when your class president tells you to. Let's put those letters back up. Let's put them up with our hearts and with our voices. Give me a P.
A.
Give me an E.
E.
Give me an N.
N.
Give me an N.
N.
Give me an E.
E.
Give me a Y.
Y.
What does it spell?
A.
What does it spell? Thank you.
Thank you, President Steve. I guess, can you top that? Our second representative is a representative of the class of 1965. He is responsible. He had the idea for the talisman, which is the name of the school yearbook. He's currently a member of our Board of Education and has some remarks to you. Thank you.
Thank you. I had a prepared speech today, but given the wilting factor out in the audience, I think I'll defer that. And just what I'd like to say is it truly is a privilege for me, as a member of the first graduating class of Penney High School, to be here with you today when a chapter in history is written for our Penney High School. I would like to thank you all, and good luck, and God bless you in whatever you may do. Thank you very much.
Members of the class, guests, it is my pleasure at this time to present our superintendent of schools for the formal commencement address, Mr. Sam Leone.
Members of the class of 1985, parents, relatives, and friends. This afternoon, we celebrate the end of an era that began in 1962 when the first students entered George J. Penney Junior Senior High School, and ends this afternoon with the graduation of the class of 1985. Although we conclude an era, the new East Hartford High School will begin its 100th year this fall at the Penney High School site. The George J. Penney Junior Senior High School opened its doors to 1,060 students, grades 7 through 10, in September of 1962. The dedication and open house was held in October. The town acquired 46 acres of land for Penney, which was the largest school site to be acquired in the history of East Hartford. Construction costs were $2,809,000. Just 2 days from the date of the dedication, bids were opened for the erection of the senior section of the building. Additional construction costs for that section were $1,200,000. By comparison, in 1973, renovations, which doubled the size of the site from 200,000 to 400,000 square feet, cost $9 million. Looking at this beautiful structure and the grounds, it is obvious why the administration and the Board of Education chose the Penney High School site for the new East Hartford High School. The library media center, auditorium, classrooms, gymnasiums, pool, and athletic facilities will provide future East Hartford High School students with a superb environment for learning. Although we say goodbye to George J. Penney High School, the name will remain as part of the new East Hartford High School. The Library Media Center has been named the George J. Penney Alumni Library. Within the library will be a collection of memorabilia, which will serve as a lasting memory of the Penney High School years. And yes, Steve, the colors, black and gold, will also remain here at the new East Hartford High School, and the cheerleaders will be waving those black and gold pom-poms. This afternoon, the class of 1985 has the distinction of being recognized as the last class to graduate from Penney High School. I sincerely hope that you will cherish the memories that you have experienced here for many years to come. My message to the class of 1985 is the same message that I gave to the graduates last evening at East Hartford High School. Others will tell you to take risks, to be yourself, never look back, or lose your faith. If the truth be told, I really don't want you to take risks. Oh, maybe a few to preserve your self-esteem. As for being yourself, that's fine as long as you're happy about yourself. Otherwise, you may want to be someone else. You will find your way. Most everyone does. Never to look back, I'd say look back quite often. Never to lose faith, of course you will. People do lose their faith. I could offer you wishes, advice, or present you with a parable. However, I would rather leave this afternoon with a story. It's about a wise man who lived a long time ago and very far away. This wise man was very kind and loving and was consequently much beloved by the people of this ancient land. In this same land, there was a nobleman, a prince, who hated this wise man. He saw the wise man as taking from him the love of the people. The people listened to the wise man, not the prince, and that angered the prince beyond belief. One day, the prince said to his followers, "I have a plan whereby I can discredit the wise man, a way in which I can make him appear to be a fool. Each day, the wise man goes to the marketplace where he speaks to the people and gives them advice. Tomorrow, when the people gather, I will go to the square disguised as a peasant. In my hand, I shall hold a white dove. When the crowd is gathered, I shall raise my voice above the crowd and say, 'Wise man, I have a simple question for you. This dove which I hold in my hand, is it alive or dead?' Now, while this appears to be a simple question, it is not, for if he says it is dead, I will open my hand and let the bird fly away. If he says it is alive, however, I will crush the bird in my hand and let it fall dead to the ground. Either way, he will be mistaken. Either way, he will appear to have made a mistake. Either way, it will appear that he cannot even tell the difference between a living and a dead bird. Either way, he will be discredited in the eyes of the people and will lose their love." The next day came, and true to his word, the prince disguised himself as a peasant, and taking a white dove, he went to the marketplace. There he waited until the crowd had gathered and the wise man had appeared. He made his way to the front of the crowd and raised his voice. "Wise man," he shouted, "I would ask you a simple question. This dove, which I hold in my hand, is it alive or is it dead?" The crowd grew quiet, and all eyes turned toward the wise man. The wise man paused, looked at the prince, and said, "That which you hold in your hand, it is what you make of it. It is what you make of it." A wise answer from a wise man. Whether the dove which the prince held was alive or dead depended upon the prince and what he did with what he had. This afternoon, I have told you about a new idea, a new concept, and now I leave it in your hands. Your future. What will you do with it? Will it be alive to soar, grow, and flourish? Or will it fall to the ground dead and unused? In the words of the wise man, it is what you make of it. Members of the class of 1985, my sincerest congratulations to you on your graduation this afternoon from George J. Penney High School. May you find success and happiness in your future endeavors. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Leon. It is my pleasant task this afternoon to announce the awards and scholarships which have already been presented to members of the class of 1985 on June 10th at our scholarship assembly. And I know many of you were present that evening. We do want to make announcements, however, of the recipients of these scholarships. Before I begin, however, I should like to make a few remarks to you and to the class. This is the last commencement ceremony at George J. Penney High School. As graduating students, you will join 7,025 students who have graduated in the past 23 years. A group of young men and women who have made their mark in our country, our state, and in our nation. Some have even lost their lives in defense of our country. Some live in foreign countries. Many live in other states and in other communities. Many have reached heights of excellence within their chosen professions, and all have taken their places within our society, many of whom live right here in East Hartford. At the conclusion of these activities, each of you will be joining this illustrious alumni group who have gone before. I would challenge each of you to continue the Penny tradition by doing your very best. You are here this afternoon because you have done just that. How true it is that doing one's best always pays off. We should never forget that our Creator gave us talents and abilities that are priceless. But it is our duty to take these and make them the very best that we can. Robert Browning once said, "My business is not to remake myself, but to make the absolute best of what God made." When we are mediocre, it is a sign that we have been callous with the talents that God gave us. We should remember the slogan that was on many years ago, letters on a billboard. There is always a best. We should never forget that the best does not come to us all at once. We arrive at our best only by being progressively better and then a little better until we reach real excellence in our work. And we reach that real excellence only after we have kept trying and trying over and over again. Our best may be remarkable or it may not be. This will depend partly upon our abilities and partly upon our zeal and toil. But this zeal and toil may not entail terrific exertion. The best is often gained by a fairly small extra effort. One needs only to think of the runner who runs only a fraction of a second ahead of the pack, but is considered the best by the average worker in one of our nation's corporations. We are told, for example, that all employees are rated for accuracy in this corporation, accuracy, promptness, getting along with others, and so forth. But those who get the promotions, the top ratings are not two or three times better, but simply 5 to 10% above the average. Yet these employees may subsequently earn 10 times much as the average worker throughout their lifetime. My message to each of you today, therefore, is to be your very best in all that you do. and you will represent yourself and your school in the years to come. Very well. Thank you. And now for the announcements of our scholarships and awards. Students, as I announce these awards, will stand in place. We will not be coming forward to the stage this afternoon since these awards have already been made. It is significant that we recognize their accomplishments, however. The George J. Penney High School Parent Teacher Awards are $150 each, and they go to the following students. Would you please hold your applause? Arthur Belville, Beth Brown, Suzanne Brown, Scott Davis, Paula Falcone, and Cheryl Federico. Would you stand, please? The Carol H. Buckley Memorial Scholarship. This is for $250. This is presented by the Office and Professional Employees International Union, Local 435. The recipient, Diane Arcand. Diane? The East Hartford Rotary Club Scholarships. There are three of them for $500 each. Michelle Burnett, Paula Falcone, and Faith Rosenshine. The East Hartford Civitan Scholarship Award for $250, Angela Frame. The East Hartford Civitan Club James Murphy Memorial Special Recognition Award for $25, Cheryl Malitsky. The Junior Women's Club of East Hartford. There are two awards. The first for $200, Cheryl Federico. And for $100, Rika Yasutake. Presidential Merit Scholarship. This is sponsored by the Hartford College for Women. It goes to two students. They're $1,000 each, Catherine Atwater and Adrian Bruggeman. The Schaefer Noble Scholarship, presented by Eastern Connecticut State University, for $500, Lorraine Fleury. The WTIC Perry Urey Scholarship, presented by Eastern Connecticut State University, for $500, Silvio Severio Cruz. The Edward T. Nurek Memorial Scholarship for $200, and there are two of these, Stephen Davis and Christine Donovan. The Rosemarie K. Nicholson Memorial Scholarship for $500, Rachel Barrett. The Harold F. Kibbe Award, this is $200 savings bond for John Armon. East Hartford Women's Club Scholarship, two recipients at $750 each, Faith Rosenshine and Rika Yasutake. The Richard H. Giardi Memorial Scholarship for $1,000, Arthur Belville. The Clarence H. Elliott Scholarships, presented by the East Hartford Education Association, for $250, Kathleen Fay. The Dr. John A. Langford Scholarship for $500, Paula Falcone. The East Hartford Club number 341 scholarships for $200 each, Jennifer Kwok and Tracy Vandekar. The Aid Association for Lutheran Scholarship for $500 each, Beth Brown and Suzanne Brown. Connecticut State Scholarship Grants for $500 each, Once again, Beth Brown and Suzanne Brown. Air Force ROTC 4-year scholarships to a university for $13,800, John Rorio. The Aetna Men's and Women's Club Scholarship for $2,000, Karen Bates. Carrie McGuire Scholarship for $300, John Corella. The Army ROTC 4-year scholarship, valued at $40,000, Michelle Burnett. The following announcements are college and university awards. These are financial aid as awarded by colleges and universities consisting of the various combinations. Scholarships, which are outright gifts of money. Loans, which are funds which students may borrow from the school. And work, which means guaranteed employment by the college or university. The announcements that I give at this time are combinations of those three considerations. Karen Bates to Trinity College, receiving $8,600 per year, $34,400 for 4 years. Beth Brown, Clark University, $9,700 first year, $38,800 for 4 years. Suzanne Brown, Clark University, $10,300 the first year, $41,200 in 4 years. Holly Lynn Cody, Bates College, $3,200 the first year, $12,800 for 4 years. Christine Donovan, Fordham University, $5,100 the first year, $20,400 for 4 years. Wendy Jenger, Bates College, $7,200 the first year, $28,800 for 4 years. Deborah Hill, Johnson and Wales College, $500 the first year, $2,000 for 4 years. Sheila Leniart, Connecticut College, $9,200 the first year, $36,800 for 4 years. Gail McKinney, St. Joseph's College, $6,000 the first year, $24,000 for 4 years. Michael O'Brien, University of Hartford, $500 the first year, $2,000 for 4 years. Faith Rosenshine, Lehigh University, $10,500 the first year, and $42,000 for 4 years. Tracy Vandekar, Honor Wilcox School of Nursing, $500 the first year, $2,000 for 4 years. And to Suzanne Brown from Anderson Jewelers, the watch which traditionally goes to the valedictorian. For your information, we have awarded in organizational scholarships $15,275 in financial aid packages from colleges. These are one-year awards I'm reading at this point. $102,500 for a grand total for one-year awards of $117,275 to this class. If you take into consideration the four-year renewables plus several awards which we have not made public at the request of the student recipients, the grand total at the scholarship assembly that we presented that evening and this afternoon we announced to you is $376,275. Now, I think it's interesting to take just a moment to talk about the class of 1985 and some of the details and some of their plans. 251 are graduating in the class. 30% will go on to four-year colleges. 20% will enter two-year colleges. 14% will be entering technical or trade schools. 23% are already employed. 5% are joining the armed forces. And 8% remain at this time undecided. In other words, 64% of the graduating class is planning to continue their formal education at some institution next year. Some other facts. 40 students are members of the National Honor Society and are identified by gold and black cords this afternoon. 4 students have received letters of commendation from the National Merit Scholarship Corporation, and all of our graduating students this afternoon are wearing gold medallions to commemorate Penny's last graduating class. And now I say farewell to the final Penny High School graduating class, the class of 1985. I shall remember you always and look forward to hearing of your accomplishments over the years. It is time at the same time for us now to join with our friends from East Hartford High School and to consolidate into one unit which we trust will be the very best. It is with great pleasure at this time that I introduce the chairman of our Board of Education, Mrs. Dorothy Carey. Mrs. Carey, would you come forward, please? Mrs. Carey, I am pleased to present the class of 1985 to you and to certify that they have successfully completed all requirements for graduation as set forth by the East Hartford Board of Education. Mrs. Carey?
Thank you. Class of 1985, distinguished guests, family, and friends. I don't know which is worse, being the first speaker on the agenda when everybody is listening to everything you're saying, or being the last speaker when probably nobody is listening. But in any event, on behalf of the entire Board of Education, I extend to the class of 1985 our sincerest congratulations and best wishes. We would also like to congratulate the families of these young people. We thank them for the love and support they have given these students during these years past as they work their way to June 22, 1985 to receive their high school diplomas. We extend to the educators of the East Hartford system our thanks also for their diligence and their perseverance in working with these students. And this year, the Board of Education would like to extend a special thanks to all of these same people, students, staff, parents, relatives, and to the East Hartford community for your patience and understanding as we planned and completed our plans for the consolidation of our middle school and our two high schools into one, which will take place in September of 1985. We know that the students have spent many long hours working with the staff, that parents and other community members have served on committees and have helped with many ideas and suggestions. We know that the students took their roles very seriously in deciding such things as the school colors, the motto, class ring, names for the newspaper, the yearbook, and the like. We witnessed this year a beginning of the consolidation as our freshmen join the students here at the Penney High School building. We saw the combining of our athletic teams and the outstanding records that they compiled, such as, for example, the football team, and just recently, the winning of the state championship by the girls' track team, the combining of the music groups and the drama clubs, and other areas of student activities such as dances and other extracurricular activities which were held during the year. We feel that the process of consolidation has been good and it has been healthy for our system. The process has given us an opportunity to examine ourselves, to look at our structure, our curriculum, our course offerings, our staffing, and like. And we feel now that we are ready for consolidation. We can look forward to September 1985 confident that because of all of your input, all of your efforts together, your cooperation, and your attitude and enthusiasm, that we will be able to have a smooth and successful transition and consolidation. We could not have done this without all of you, and we thank you. And again, I would like to congratulate the class of 1985 for your accomplishments, which have brought you to your high school graduation. We wish you all the very best of luck in the future, wherever life's paths may take you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Carey. I am advised that the photographer that we had scheduled perhaps is on an evening sequence. I have no idea at this point, but he has not arrived. We do have a small photography area off to my left for taking pictures, and we would ask that you stay in that area and make it the front available to the people that are seated in the seats. At this time, Mrs. Carey will proceed with the presentation of diplomas to all members of the class of 1985. She will be assisted in the reading of the names by Mr. Ronald Schmidt, First Assistant Principal. Thank you. Caroline Adrian Agnelli. Sean Marie Olivo. Stephanie Renee Amos. Diane Michelle Arcand. Catherine Atwater. Patricia Ann Avery. Ann Benavong. Mary Kate Barnett. Sonia N. Barron. Rachel E. Barrett. Karen Elizabeth Bates. Lisa Bell. Laura Lee Bidwell. Elizabeth A. Bennett. Carol Linda Blaze. Deborah Elaine Bornstein. Jean Marie Bradley. Beth A. Brown. Suzanne C. Brown. Adrian Bruggerman. Janet Burley. Michelle Ann Burnett. Michelle Ann Camilleri. Sigdayo Shantarak. Joanne Madeline Sharon. Beverly Ann Chitwood. Elaine Clark. Allison Clark. Carolyn Coleman. Lori Cormier. Holly Lynn Cote. Lori Ann Cote. Paige E. Dakin. Victoria Lynn Del Judas. Tina Marie DeLuco. Deborah Ann DeShane. Tracy Donahue. Christine G. Donovan. Francine M. D'Razio. Joan Marie Dowd. Christina Ethorn. Lily Ann Elvestad. Mary Ellen Evans. Paula Ann Falcone. Kathleen Fay. Karen Lynn Fagan. Cheryl Y. Federico. Lori Elaine Fitzgerald. Lorraine Elaine Fleury. Lorraine Allison Fleury. Terry Fox. Angela Renee Frame. Mary Freeman. Susan Barbara Geary. Wendy Ann Marie Georges. Diane E. Gilbert. Sandra E. Gilbert. Catherine Mary Gokey. Kristen Maureen Gove. Deborah Ann Gilliam. Kristen Beth Hannum. Deborah Marie Hill. Diana Lee Hutchins. Leslie Hutt. Kathleen J. Jensen. Sandra L. Johnson. Monique Yvette Jones. Lisa M. Kaladich. Kimberly Alice Klett. Mary Beth Cravies. Jennifer Kwok. Corinne Michelle LaHart. Lori Leita. June Marguerite Lawler. Sheila M. Lenyart. Claudine Susan Lurs. Sandra Ann Lewis. Candace Lundy. Patricia Ann Mahoney. Cheryl Marie Malitsky. Kim Muloff. Karen May. Mary Elizabeth McDonald. Tracy McGinnis. Gail Louise McKinney. Margarita Melendez. Michelle Arlene Maloney. Julia Monique Menifee. Elena Meneses. Marianne R. Metzing. Brenda Lynn Michaud. Constance Morrison. Diane Adele Mount. Paula Ann Masillo. Kathleen Ann Nagel. Joyce Oliver. Rosalind M. Pantano. Nita N. Patel. Stephanie Diana Patty. Robin Ann Perrin. Tracy Maria Petroselli. Danny S. Pomerlo. Sheila Richard. Dawn Marie Robinson. Nancy Rachel Rodrigue. Faith Susan Rosenshine. Andrea Rutinger. Christy Lynn Ruggiero. Joan Savides. Janet L. Scolo. Diane M. Sexton. Michelle C. Shive. Michelle St. Pierre. Dawn Ann Stannard. Bonnie A. Stefanik. Cheryl Lee Swanson. Brenda Sylvester. Cheryl Ann Thistle. Christina H. Thurs. Carrie Lynn Tomkunis. Marie Jose Toruntegay. Tracy Lee Vandekar. Nancy Walker. Dawn Lynn Watson. Sharon Whaler. Pamela Christine Weaver. Michelle L. Winham. Rika Yoshitake. Deborah A. Zadrozny. John H. Rorio. Alex Orios. John E. Armand Jr. John Joseph Byros. Sanovan Tang Benavong. Sean Andrew Barrett. Arthur Gene Belville. James Berube. Anthony J. Betts. Timothy John Bister. Kevin A. Brown. Michael J. Carrier. Rui Carvalho. Kevin Charest. David M. Chirico. Matthew Cohen. Peter Connolly. Bernard Corcoran. Silverio Cruz. Douglas D'Alessandro. Mark Damashi. Scott Matthew Davis. Stephen J. Davis. David J. DeDominicus. Russell E. DeRocher, Jr. Brian Donovan. Brian David Doucette. Kenya Omar Eastman. Christian M. Edwards. Richard Martin Ellington. David Fleming. Timothy Fournier. Richard Freeman. Michael Garneau. J. Fred Godfrey. Mark Gazdecki. William F. Grant III. Daniel Ronald Groseski. Randy W. Gdoskis. William Harrison. Brian Scott Highland. William A. Irvin. Joseph J. Izzo, Jr. Ronald P. Jackman. William E. Kane. Keith B. Kerleza. Ronald J. Klemba. Timothy J. Cleva. Andrew John Kowajczyk. David Peter Kowal. Scott A. Legacy. Anthony D. Lawrence. Glenn Robert Ledoux. Michael Lindsay. Stephen Lysick. Jeff J. Madura. Mark Anthony Maher. William John Malitsky. Richard A. Marquez. Jason P. Michaud. Mark T. Mungin. Craig Anthony Moore. Robert William Morgan. Robert L. Machino. David Anthony Masinski. Charles Napolitano. Vance E. Nash. Michael C. O'Brien. Sean O'Connell. Stephen D. Ogren. Stanley Osinski. Thomas J. Peruccio. Daniel J. Petrella. Scott Jason Poverman. Michael Thomas Rago. Ronald Ramspeck. Christopher William Riley. Robert John Risley. Aaron Roan. Robert Peter Rojas. Sean Oliver Alexander Royal. Carbert C. Russell. Brian D. Sebastio. Scott Savoy. Kevin Scheimer. Vincent Eric Scott. Mario Silva. Scott Skates. Andre Sowell. Alan M. St. Laurent. Michael Sula. Parker L. Swan, Jr. Michael Robert Sylvester. Jeffrey Thomas Toyer. Craig Stefan Matthew Thibodeau. Christian Thomas. Brian D. Tickle. Andrew J. Torini. Kevin Turley. Kevin Vaughn. Claudio Vecchiarino. Matthew S. Vroblick. Gary Michael Wallace. Alexander Edward Wiz. Richard L. Wojnillo. Christopher Yaneros. Our Vice President, Timothy Kuchar. The President of the Class of 1985, John Carella.
Since our school's gone the way of the dinosaurs, I won't be passing the traditional senior banner to the incoming president of the next year's class. So rather, I'll present it to Mr. Kramer right now to place in the memorabilia collection. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. We'll take good care of it.